Hello, Dushyanth.
Hi.
I had a couple of questions. This always comes into our mind, and especially in my children's mind. So who is God?
This is a very interesting question, Priya, but I don't know if there's a definite answer to it. But what I can of course assure you of giving answers which Hinduism, which our ancient scriptures have always stated. At the outset, God cannot be a one. We need to first eliminate those possibilities which a God, the person whom we personify as God, cannot be. God cannot be someone who differentiates. We have this quality embedded in us to check, I like this person, I don't like that person. This question of likes and dislikes can never come in the perception of God. Second is, God can never get into the likelihood of having an inclination towards one particular party. It cannot be a political party. You belong to me, so I like you. Until you belong to me, I will not like you. That can never be God. So God has to be one who is above all these worldly feelings. So now we need to first understand who this God is. So Shastras in Hinduism have given certain qualities to God which are very essential qualities or essential characteristics. I'm sure since you posed this question of your children having this question of who is God, I'm sure they'll be loving chocolates.
Yes.
And there's one very famous chocolate, though we are not into branding, the famous chocolate that children like is Ferrero Rocher. So there's this Ferrero Rocher which has a very, very appealing structure outside with nuts embedded from all sides. And then there is another layer of chocolate ball inside, and in the core part is the nut. Likewise, God, in his essential form in the first sphere, has five qualities, says the Shastram.
Okay.
The first most important quality is that he is not bound by karma.
Okay.
You're sitting here, I'm sitting here,
okay,
or the person, whoever is watching this, is sitting, because we are bound to speak, you're bound to ask, I'm bound to answer, that person is bound to listen.
Okay.
So this bound to is coming from the word bondage.
Okay.
So what causes bondage is our actions.
Okay.
So these actions lead to bondage.
Okay.
So the moment actions come in, there is an intermediate position called karma which is attached. So karma leads us to this level where we are in bondage and we are bound to.
Okay.
The one whom we designate as God should be the one who is outside bondage. So if he has to be outside bondage, then there should be no karma. If there is no karma, then his or her actions should not cause that karma. So this person should be exempt from karma.
Okay.
This particular quality of not being bound by karma, which is for us and not for that God, makes the first quality of God.
Okay.
And this is often referred to in Shastram as Satyatvam.
Okay.
Then you've got knowledge. For example, you ask me a question as to what Ramayana states. To some extent, I can manage answering it because my preceptors were benevolent enough to bless me with that quintessential knowledge. But if you ask me what the Zen, the Avesta tells, I know there's a book, holy book like that, but I wouldn't know what is there in it. In Ramayana itself, if you ask me this particular verse, in which particular sargam it comes, I may not know the exact number. So what happens in our case, the human scenario is, we are adept with knowledge,
yes,
but that knowledge is restricted to certain fields, and in those fields that we choose, it is restricted to certain level. That's why even in our courses, we have this beginner level, proficiency, visharad, and so on. So our knowledge, there's a saying in English, Priya, jack of all, master of none. I would rather put it this way, we are all jack of none, master of none. So we know something somewhere.
Right.
And this also doesn't exist at all points in time, if you check.
Yes. Yes.
Today I know Ramayana because 5 years before I learnt it from my Acharya.
Right.
15 years before I didn't know Ramayana because I was not given that knowledge. Right. So knowledge is restricted to fields, it is restricted to levels, and it is also restricted to time period.
Yes.
So this is called Jnana Sankocham, wherein knowledge itself undergoes contraction and expansion.
Right.
The one who we designate as God should be exempt from this contraction and expansion of knowledge. Okay. That is called Jnanatvam.
Okay.
So the first is Satyatvam, now comes Jnanatvam. Third is the quality of being infinite. See, often people who follow Hinduism or who revere Hinduism will be aware of one interesting section in Vedas, which is often referred to as Purusha Suktam. So in Purusha Suktam, the first line is very interesting. It talks about the Supreme Deity with 1,000 heads. Sahasra Shirshah Purushaha. Now how is he? Further it goes to elucidate, stating Sahasrakshaha. Now, Akshi is the eye. Sahasrakshaha means one with 1,000 eyes. But imagine what was said before 1,000 heads. So ideally, how many eyes should have been there? 2,000. So now comes the very basic literal imagination that we have to imagine a person with one face and one single eye. But this is not what the Purusha Suktam intends to tell us. It tells that the person whom you speak or revere has thousands and thousands and thousands of heads, thousands and thousands and thousands of eyes. Sahasrapat, he has got thousands of legs. So what it tells is the person whom you revere as God has eyes everywhere, has legs everywhere. For me to reach point B from point A, I have to use my legs to walk. But the Lord doesn't have to, because he has legs everywhere. He has eyes everywhere. We have this Indian mentality especially. We take the crumbled paper and how much ever we speak in the public, just before casting it away, we just look around to check if there are no eyes falling on us. But the Purusha Suktam is very, very adamant, and it has the audacity to tell there are eyes looking at you. So this quality of being infinite, he himself, Tanakku Tan Tanmai Ariyadan, is a beautiful saying in Tamil, which says that he wouldn't know his own quality. So this level of being infinite, not with any boundary, without any antam, is Ananta. So this quality of his existence or her existence with no limit is called Anantatvam. So Satyatvam, Jnanatvam, Anantatvam. Then you've got the quality of bliss. English may be a bit confusing, but now that we have chosen it as a medium of conversation, we need to understand what happiness is first. In nouns, you often classify nouns as common nouns, proper nouns, and abstract nouns. Abstract nouns are those nouns where you can't define them thoroughly. They are feelings. For example, I want peace. If someone asks, define peace. Peace is peace. What will I say more than that? So I start fumbling. So finding definite actions or definitions for such abstract nouns is tough. So one such abstract noun is happiness. So I say, I'm happy. The next question is, you'll be asking me, what will be the next question if I say I'm happy? How happy are you? I need to first define the level. Next, other question with related to happiness.
What gives you
happiness? So what gives me happiness? So it's the human mentality that there should be some object or an incident that gives me happiness.
Correct.
Without that, there's no such feeling. If the child craves for chocolate and mother makes chocolate, oh, I wanted the chocolate and here I've got the chocolate. That instantaneous feeling of feeling joyful is happiness. The moment the child starts consuming the sweet, that feeling evaporates or erodes. But imagine there is a state where one feels happy for no reason. That happiness comes for no reason. Because it has never come for any reason, it will not go for no reason.
Absolutely.
So it will stay throughout. That state of feeling happy for no reason is called bliss. And that bliss is what Vedanta defines as Anandam.
Okay.
So Anandatvam is the next quality of the Lord.
Okay.
So he is always in the state of bliss.
Okay.
He is infinite.
Okay.
His glory is infinite.
Okay.
His knowledge doesn't undergo contraction and expansion.
Okay.
And he is not bound by karma.
Okay.
But imagine, with all such good qualities, he has some deficiencies. Because in our human life we say, oh, that person, very interesting man, very, very interesting, you know, he's a very good friend. But When I use the word but, then there's something negative that's going to follow it. So I say the Lord is embedded with Satyatvam, Jnanatvam, Anantatvam, Anandatvam, but then it defies the purpose of Lord, because the Lord should not be like me. See, if I have to propitiate or salute someone, I salute someone who's better than me and who's not like me. If he is also or she is also as blemishful or flawful like me, why will I go? So this state of being blemishless, flawless, mistakeless, errorless is called amalatvam. Malam in Sanskrit means dirt. Amalam means the state of being without the dirt, without the bliss. It's called amalatvam. So you've got satyatvam, jnanatvam, anantatvam, anandatvam, amalatvam. So these are the essential characteristics of the first layer of Ferrero Rocher of God. Okay. So this is called Swarupa Nirupaka Dharmam, that which essentially defines God. So the moment I say these qualities, I will know that I have mostly none of them. I am not in a blissful state. You're taking an interview of me. I'm happy that you're taking the interview, because you're taking the interview, I'm happy. But now that you're asking me a question, I'm worried that how will I answer? So the state of bliss is going away. So there's this state of bliss which is not in me. I'm bound by karma, because after some time I'll feel hungry, I'll feel thirsty, I'll feel sleepy. And my knowledge today, you ask me 10 years later, imagine my state of mind is not good. I would have even forgotten that such a thing happened. So everything, whatever we have spoken of God, is absent in me. Since I need to aspire for some state or someone who's better than me, God's essential qualities are these. But all these qualities speak of Him as a very supreme person. But imagine the a toddler has to reach you. You go to your friend's place, Priya, and they have a child. And the child is very cute, looking one of those advertisement babies. And you want to have the child. And you sit in your place, the child will never come to you.
Absolutely.
What you would need to do is to take that walk that extra mile, go to that child, do all that the child likes and pleases, and then say, come here, and you take all the efforts. So God sits with Satyatvam, Jnanatvam, Anantatvam, Anandatvam, Amalatvam. That's not going to help me. I don't want such a person who's sitting in his chair. He has to come all the way to me, impress upon me, hug me, kiss me, and take me away. So these qualities that make Him mingle with us is called Saulabhyam and Saushilyam. That's what the Lord did when He was born as Rama. He moved with Guha, who was absolutely unhygienic. He moved with Sugriva, who was absolutely fickle-minded. He moved with Shabari, who had no interest in life except serving her own teacher. So His ability of moving and mingling with all made Him Saushilya. Krishna, in fact, He was nurtured in an environment where people were showering love on Him. And all the more love He showered on them. So God, if He has to impress upon us, He needs to come down and showcase these qualities. These qualities are not essential characteristics of the Lord, but they are qualities that He tries to impress us with. So this is called as Nirupita Swarupa Viseshanam. So this forms the external layer of the Ferrero Rocher. So what impresses about God is Saulabhyam and Saushilyam. But when that layer goes away, the essential part is Swarupa Nirupaka Dharma, which is 5 in number. So we have seen God. But again, what we started off is the basic definition that God can never differentiate. If He says or she says that you should be born as a Hindu, and then only I like you, then that is no God. If that God says, you are a man, so I love you, you are a woman, so you're one step less, that's no God. If that God says, you give me this, then I will give you. If it's a barter system, then it's no God. If that God says, you believe in me only if you are a theist, I will give you. And if you're an atheist, I'll never give you, then that is no God. Whether the person is an atheist or a theist, whether the person is the one who believes in this religion or does not believe, whether the person is of a male, a female, or a transgender, beyond all these worldly existence is what we call God. And that God needs to be present everywhere. And where is that God? and that God is in us. So it's very, very important to bring that supreme existence inside us. That's why God is in you, God is in me. But He is in a very dormant state.
Right.
He has given us the free will to act. And as long as that free will acts in the right fashion, we will be able to realize God. And how do we know whether it's right or wrong? Comes the Shastram, which is a later part.
Okay.
So, God is essentially the one who's embedded with all supreme characteristics. And He has got all auspicious attributes.
Yeah.
And He is flawless. And He is yearning to reach us. And this is God.
Lovely.
Thank you.
It's a fabulous answer.